Governments pursue numerous policies to improve social welfare, and many of these have been extensively studied. But how do we bridge the gap between individual policy evaluations and the broader question of what the government should do? If we know that expanding health insurance improves mortality, but also that financial aid increases college attendance, and that housing vouchers allow families to move to better neighborhoods, how do we decide where the government should invest its resources? This paper develops a framework for answering this question and uses it to determine which public policies have been most effective in the US over the past half century. The analysis spans 133 policy changes across four domains: social insurance, education, taxes and cash transfers, and in-kind transfers. To apply a standard measure of effectiveness, the authors calculate each policy's marginal value of public funds, or its MVPF. This is the ratio between the benefit that a policy provides to its recipients and its net cost to the government. Policies with higher MVPFs are more effective in the sense of providing greater benefit per dollar of government spending. In essence, they have greater bang for the buck. Importantly, this denominator incorporates both the upfront costs of a given policy, as well as any long-run effects on the government's budget. If a policy increases recipients' incomes in the long run, this leads to higher tax revenue for the government, which lowers the policy's net cost. If these long-run effects are large enough to fully offset the initial cost, the policy pays for itself and the MVPF is infinite. To illustrate, consider expanding access to college. The authors draw from a 2014 paper studying the impact of admission to Florida International University. This work finds that FIU admission causes students' earnings to fall in the first 7 years after admission, but earnings rise in years 8 to 14. Using these and other estimates from the Zimmerman paper, the authors decompose the net cost of admitting an additional student to FIU. First, they tally the upfront cost. After accounting for various factors, this amounts to $2,600 per admitted student. Next, the impact on earnings means that tax revenue is lower, and, therefore, the net cost of the policy is higher during the first 7 years after admission, but higher earnings thereafter lead to higher tax revenues and lower costs. In fact, the authors estimate that the increase in tax revenue from year 8 onwards is substantial enough to push the cumulative net cost negative by year 14. In other words, by the time she turns 33, the marginal admit has repaid the upfront cost of sending her to FIU in the form of higher tax revenues. The policy pays for itself, and the MVPF is infinite. Do we see a similar dynamic in other cases? The authors use the results from existing policy evaluations to systematically calculate the MVPFs of 133 historical policies. This figure shows the results. Each dot represents an individual policy, while diamonds are category averages for each policy type. MVPFs are plotted against the average age of each policy's beneficiaries. Policies on the left primarily affect children, and those on the right affect adults. So, what do we see? The primary finding is that investments in the health and education of low-income children have historically had the highest MVPFs. Policies including health insurance expansions, childhood education spending, and expenditures on college have generated the greatest benefit per dollar of government spending. In fact, many of these policies pay for themselves in the long run. this figure focuses on the MVPF denominator and shows that investments in children typically have negative net costs. As with the FIU example, the child beneficiaries of these programs often have higher earnings in adulthood and end up paying back the initial cost through higher tax revenue. Now, it's important to highlight several caveats when interpreting these results. First, the broader patterns don't always hold across each individual policy. Some college policies, for example, have very low MVPFs. These tend to be policies that provide transfers to existing students without actually changing their educational attainment. Second, policies with low MVPFs provide less benefit per dollar of government spending, but this does not mean they are undesirable. If one policy has an MVPF of 1, while another has an MVPF of 2, the government prefers spending on policy 2 if and only if providing $2 to this group is valued more than providing $1 to this group. In other words, the optimal policy choice depends on how we weight the welfare of these two groups. As a case in point, the authors find relatively low MVPFs for transfers to disabled children. Nonetheless, these policies may be welfare enhancing if supporting this population is a societal priority. Finally, while policies targeting adults tend to have lower MVPFs, there are two notable exceptions: reductions in top marginal tax rates, and policies that have large spillovers to children. For example, policies that enable families to move to high opportunity neighborhoods increase children's earnings in adulthood, thereby generating large MVPFs. This reinforces a key takeaway of the paper. Policies that raise children's human capital often have the biggest bang for the buck. In conclusion, this paper presents a framework for conducting a unified welfare analysis across different policies. Importantly, the authors note that the same approach can be applied beyond the setting studied here. MVPFs can help guide the analysis of crime policies, environmental policies, and many others. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include research on the long-run effects of investing in children, those exploring whether some government expenditures pay for themselves, and finally, the many papers whose policy evaluations provided the estimates used to calculate MVPFs.